This episode is sponsored by Squarespace. Go to squarespace.com/microcosmos to save 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain. When James, our master of microscopes, was looking through samples he'd received from Spain, he didn't expect to see this. A creature straight out of a horror movie, with dark, reddish-brown eyes and tentacles streaming out of its mouth. We believe this is a tube worm, and the fact that it seems to just be sitting there makes it maybe even more unsettling. Like, any moment, it could change its mind and use one of those many appendages to reach out from the screen for your face. It would be weird to look at this tube worm and expect to find some common ground with it. But even anxiety-inducing creatures from the microcosmos have something in common with us. We are both of us entirely beholden every moment of our lives to a tiny little chemical called oxygen. We're going to return to the tube worms in a bit. For now, let's talk about oxygen. Not every organism is as dependent as we are on oxygen. Anaerobic organisms like diplomonads make energy through different chemical reactions than what you will find in aerobic organisms like us. In fact, many anaerobic organisms have trouble surviving in oxygen-filled environments. Billions of years ago, anaerobic organisms like these were the norm, filling in a version of our Earth we would hardly recognize. And would definitely have not been able to survive in, because there was hardly any oxygen. That would change sometime before 2.5 billion years ago, when cyanobacteria began to take over the Earth, bringing in a new innovation, a form of photosynthesis that produced oxygen as a byproduct. We've talked about this great oxidation event before, and how it was simultaneously catastrophic and fortunate. Among the many changes this influx of oxygen brought to our planet, the emergence of chemical pathways involving oxygen to produce energy would set the stage for the vast array of aerobic organisms we see today. And what's fascinating is that as we look through the different organisms of the microcosmos, we can see the same underlying principles leading to very different strategies to get the oxygen each organism needs. For single-celled eukaryotes, or protists, the task is seemingly simple. They just absorb oxygen from their surroundings, letting it diffuse across their membranes into their bodies. They don't need any mechanisms or special organelles to get access to that oxygen. This reliance on diffusion means that protists depend on the amount of surface area they have exposed to the water around them to be able to get as much oxygen as they can, but otherwise, seems like a pretty straightforward way to breathe. It does get a little messier than that, though. Different species have different oxygen preferences. Loxodes, for example, like microaerobic areas that have some, but not much, oxygen. These preferences are likely shaped by a number of factors, like the habits of preferred prey, the ability to rely on other chemical pathways for energy, and the fact that oxygen itself is, despite all that it provides, quite damaging. In general, oxygen levels are lower as you go deeper into a body of water, so for Loxodes to find the depths it can thrive in, it relies on organelles called Müller vesicles that help it essentially know where down is. And that shows us one of the things that's useful for all organisms. We all need to find the right level of oxygen. Even some of the most famously resilient members of the microcosmos are vulnerable without oxygen. As we look at myofauna, which are tiny little invertebrates like rotifers, we start to see body parts that feel familiar, like stomachs and reproductive organs. But when it comes to oxygen, many of these organisms are like protists. They rely on diffusion to deliver oxygen from the water around them and through them. It might be a little more difficult if their body is covered in a cuticle, but it works. But while we're staring at a tardigrade, we should probably point something out. They are not particularly good swimmers. All those legs are better coordinated for their waddling gaits. This puts them at a disadvantage compared to some of the other members of the myofauna, who can swim up and down and around to find oxygen. But, like, what's the worst that can happen to tardigrades without a little oxygen? Can't they just curl up into their resting tun states, which seems to protect them from so many other environmental threats? Well, surprisingly, no. This is what happens to a tardigrade without oxygen. It gets very, very still, and very, very swollen. This is very different from forming a compact little tun, but tuns are just one of several ways that tardigrades enter what's called cryptobiosis, where their metabolism comes to a pause. Tuns are the cryptobiotic response tardigrades turn to in the face of a particular environmental challenge, like dryness. But we don't know as much about how this response to a lack of oxygen works, though one explanation is that the mechanism controlling the amount of water in the tardigrade's body begins to fail when there is a lack of oxygen, leading to this swelling. The tardigrade can emerge from this state when oxygen returns. In fact, James sometimes finds that if he blows gently on the slide, the tardigrades return to life. In one recent study, scientists found that tardigrades were able to come back to life after even a severe lack of oxygen. But the longer the tardigrades went without, the less likely they were to survive. And that brings us back to tube worms, which are bigger than the myofauna we've been watching, and yet face their own challenges. In particular, tube worms are, as the name suggests, encased in a tube. We're guessing here as non-tube worm experts, but the white spiral tubes that these worms live in look a bit like the tubes that Spirorbis tube worms live in. But if anyone can help us identify these worms, please let us know. Spirorbis tube worms are found around Northwest Europe, and at their head is a crown of tentacles, sometimes better known as the tentacular crown. This crown helps the worm get food, filtering water in search of nourishment. But it also doubles as a tool for respiration, with thin epithelia that are able to take in oxygen through diffusion, like the other organisms we've seen. On the one hand, it makes sense to get as much use out of a single part of the body as you can. On the other hand, that's a vital apparatus, just hanging around outside, where it is vulnerable to predators. So to protect themselves, the worm can quickly retract its tentacles back into the safe confines of its tube, leaving it able to breathe another day. Looking at the tube worm's tentacles, James was reminded of something else, of us. Our bodies have their own branching organ to help us take in oxygen, the lungs, which are their own complex take on many of the same ideas of diffusion and surface area that we've seen play out in these organisms. And when we look across these organisms, all these adaptations come down to one thing, oxygen, a tiny little molecule of gas that was once barely a part of this world. Thank you for coming on this journey with us as we explore the unseen world that surrounds us. And thank you to Squarespace for sponsoring this episode. Squarespace offers a robust online platform that empowers small businesses to create their own websites. Whether you're just starting out or looking to expand your existing venture, Squarespace provides all the essential features you need to succeed. Maybe you are a talented yoga instructor and you want to establish a captivating online presence for your studio. Squarespace provides you with all the tools to design a beautiful and professional website that reflects your studio's tranquil ambiance and captures the essence of your teaching style. Utilizing Squarespace's third-party extensions, you can effortlessly manage class schedules, streamline bookings, and offer yoga sessions to students around the globe. And if you're interested in sharing your yoga knowledge and inspiration with a broader audience, Squarespace makes it easy to integrate a blog seamlessly into your website. You can enlighten your readers with insightful articles, yoga techniques, and mindfulness practices, fostering a deeper connection with your community. And you can even engage with your students through threaded comments and replies as you encourage discussions, offer guidance, and celebrate their progress as they embark on their yoga journey. You can sign up for free today at squarespace.com, and when you're ready to launch, you can visit squarespace.com/microcosmos to enjoy a 10% discount on your first purchase of a website or domain. The people on the screen right now They are some of our Patreon patrons. They make it so that we can continue to explore all of these bizarre little bits of our universe. Isn't it nice that the cyanobacteria created oxygen for all of us to breathe? And isn't it nice that our Patreon patrons helped us create this show? If you would like to join them, you can go to patreon.com/journeytomicro. If you want to see more from our master of microscopes, James Weiss, you can check out Jam and Germs on Instagram. And if you want to see more from us, there's probably a subscribe button somewhere nearby.